Quiet down, team. Quiet down, team. Quiet down. Quiet down. Quiet down. Well, I just wondered what we're going to be having today. I know y'all are real hype. Amen. And so I thank you for that. But what we're going to be getting ready to prepare for, I know y'all hype, so I brung in some special players for us that's going to do a rap for us, amen, called Deep Dimension. And after that, we're going to have to really dig deep in to seeing what God has for us, because we are what? Game changers. So as they get ready to come in, because today, the owner, Dr. Adam Blackstock of GBFIC Eagles, is coming in. And so I can't have a bad rap for my name. And so we want to make sure that when he get here, that he has a good report. Amen. So one of the things is, so I know y'all hyped, so I had this little speech, because you've been doing a great job for the entire year. Amen. You see, 11 years. And we're getting ready to go into our 12 years. So I want to bring our special guest to come on down here and encourage the GBFIC Eagles. Where are the cheerleaders at? GBFIC Eagles! All right, come on down.
Hallelujah. Go. Where did mascot Eagles come from? Where did Eagles come from? I get it later. I'm out the loop. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Where my game changers at? Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We prepared a special little theme song for y'all. I hope you like it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Turn it up.
You can say what you want to, but I had to step back, take a look at my bloodline. Generation after generation losing out. They refuse salvation and the love Christ is giving out. Break away from the curse, trying to stun my growth. Try to silence me, it's like a punch in the throat. Silence not an option, so I'm changing the game. Breaking generational curses out my family, man. Come on.
Made in the Father's image. Time to be about his business. We in the world, we got a mission. No time for playing, set aside all distractions. Time to focus on the vision. If you only knew how God's been good to me, then you would know why the devil is mad at me. Satan says we'll never make it, but we know that he's just hating. My God calls the chosen. He says we're victorious. So who you gonna listen to? I said, who you gonna listen to? Don't let the devil trick you into thinking that you're powerless. Truth is, you're a force to be reckoned with. And I'm a game changer. Come on, declare and decree today. Here we go, say, I'm a game changer. Hey. Say, I'm a game changer, cause he changed me.
Cause he changed me.
This side, let me hear you say, come on, say, I'm a game changer. Put your helmet on this side, say, I'm a game changer. Come on, say, all together now. I'm a game changer, cause ooh, he changed me.
He changed me.
Back up in it, now I'm winning. You thought I was losing, bro. How I'm gonna lose when Christ is everything I need, yo. The author of my life, he put that comma behind my end. Come when on. It should have been a period. He gave me a second chance to get it right. Now it's on, kid. Some don't understand why I give him all the glory. Just sit back and pay attention, then you understand my story. Cause we overcome the devil with the blood of the lamb and our testimony. See, I was shot when I was 25. Ain't easy being paralyzed. The doctor said I'd die, but by the grace of God, I'm still alive. How can I ignore him when he saved me from my hellish fate? Come on. 2 years of depression and I cried almost every day. Now I see the picture and he painted me a clear view.
Come on.
Jesus is my everything. The world is in my rear view. So I stop all my complaining, started trusting God's plan. Basic instruction before leaving earth, man.
If I am.
Come on.
Connected to greatness if I am. Filled with your spirit if I am. Made in your image. And what does that say about me?
Oh, I'm a game changer.
I'm a game changer, say.
I'm a game changer.
Hey, say I'm a game changer.
I'm a game changer.
Cause he changed me.
He changed me.
Oh, I'm a game changer. I'm a game changer.
I'm
say.
A game changer.
Break it down now.
He's been good to me. Say he's been good to me. Hey. Say he's been good to me. Say he's been good to me.
Break it down now.
Say he's been good to me. Say he's been good
to
me.
We're going to take him by the church one time. Come on.
Say he's been good to me.
Repeat after me if you know the words.
Say to me.
Hey. I'm a soldier
in the army of the Lord.
I'm a soldier.
In the army,
say I'm a soldier.
In the army of the Lord,
I'm a soldier.
In the army,
come on, say, I got my war clothes on.
In the army of the Lord,
I got my helmet on.
In the army,
hey, I got my war clothes on.
In the army of the Lord,
I got my war clothes on.
In the army,
cause he's been good to me. Say,
hey,
he's been good to me.
Say, he's been good to me.
Come on now,
he's been good to me. Say, he's been good to me.
Sing it louder. Say,
he's been good to me. Say, he's been good to me.
Brother Law, now, come on.
He's been good to me. Say, he's been good to me.
Hey,
he's been good to me.
Hallelujah.
He's been good to me.
Can I hear it?
He's been good to me. Say, he's been good to me.
Has he been good to you?
He's been good to me. Say, he's been good to me.
He's been good to me, y'all.
He's been good to me. Say, he's been good to me.
Hey,
amen.
Ain't no party like a Holy Ghost party, cause a Holy Ghost party don't stop. See, saints don't dance, man, we groove. We want the whole church just to move.
I took your line.
Did you enjoy that GBFIC Eagles? Okay, we need to handle some business before the owner get here, amen. We have learned, we had to go through some plays that made our team better about 3 weeks ago, where we made a statement that as the team, the battle that we was taking and the battle that we was doing, we were not playing with the devil, amen. Regardless of what team we play, regardless of what position we're in, that is the team leader that we're trying to conquer. And so the owner came in and he has been evaluating some things, and so I wanted to make sure that before he get here, if I can get some of my players over here can help me pass these out on this side, and I can get someone for this side. If you can pass these out so that you can follow along. I want to thank our visitors for being here. We got some new members that may be deciding to join the team. Amen. And we want to thank those of you that Deep Dimension that came in to just keep give our spirits pep, amen? We got to understand that praise is a weapon. Praise energizes us, amen? So before we get started here, you know, I always want to open up with prayer. Because without prayer, we can't get much accomplished in playing on these battlefields. So Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we just thank you. We thank you for this new direction that you're taking the GBFIC Eagles. We thank you, Lord, that we are game changers for Christ, that we will be the ones that will hold up the bloodstained banner, that will give you all the glory for our story. And so in doing that, Lord, we ask that as you speak to each and every one of us, every team player under the sound of my voice, that you're going to speak to us and give us a plan of action, a play that we can utilize to be a game changer spiritually, physically, emotionally, mentally, financially, sexually, and socially. So we thank you for that, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So as we had one of the guests that came from, that was here, that just did the pep, encouraging words for us through song, one of the things he stated, he says, how did they get the title Eagles? Where did that come from? And so because we may have some new individuals that have joined the team, I want to share with you the importance of you being an eagle. And as it referenced also for this team, that is, you are a prophetic team. Amen. So it's not a coincidence that some of you are here, a part of this team and not other teams, because the mascot that Christ has given us is that of an eagle. An eagle emblem symbolizes spiritual and divine omnipresence and victory, the omnipresence of God and the victory of God. Also, it's a prophetic bird accepted by the Old Testament as a symbol of Yahweh's prophets. So it's not a coincidence that this house have prophets. It's not a coincidence that some of you are sitting under my voice, that you have prophetic gifts. That's in Ezekiel 17 and 3. That's one of our playbooks that you can read. Represent the eagle as a symbol of great and powerful kings. And that's why the men on this team, you are called to be what? King and priests. So God has just given us more ways to show us how we can be victorious. Because when you're out there on the battlefield, you know that you're not a buzzard. You're not a chicken. You are an eagle. You are meant to fly. You are meant to soar. One of the things about an eagle is that an eagle is able also, you're not supposed to be whining and crying and thinking that you are not victorious, because as an eagle, you are able to soar in the midst of a storm. So tell when you see your fellow team members looking like they had a hard time on the battlefield, remind them that you are an eagle. Everything you need, God has already provided and put it in you. Let's look at Isaiah 40 and 31, if we can get that up on the board. And if we have any team players that have that quicker than what they're putting it up on the board, you can read that. I just really feel that when the owner, Dr. Adam Blackstock, gets here, he's going to have even more encouraging words to give us, but we should also know that we have done a good job. It has been an honor to coach this team.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. It's an honor to be a part of this team.
Do we have it?
Isaiah 40 and 31.
Yes.
But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagle. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint.
Do you see that, team? That you're supposed to walk and not faint. And when it's time for you not to walk, then you are to run. And on this team, we're going to run to see what the end is going to bring. They, the Eagles, they are equated with spiritual quickening and earthly renovation. The quarterbacks, the runners, the halfbacks, you are supposed to be quick. And whatever God is having us, whatever battle that we're in, you have the potential to be able to be a earthly, to have earthly renovation. The eagle distinguishes itself as a powerful bird of prey that is also tender towards its young. So you see that you also have the tenderness as well as the boldness. And so we have some young team members that is on that are on this team. So the older eagles that have been among us a long time, you are to show them the way. If you are a single team member, you are supposed to make sure that you, for your little eagle that is being brought up, you're supposed to make sure that you connect with the right male eagle. One of the things that an eagle, a female eagle does, is that when she's choosing her mate, is that she goes up to the highest point of a mountain or a tree, and she drops a branch. And that male eagle is supposed to be able to catch that branch. If he does not catch that branch and it hits the ground, she will not mate with him. Because it's a sign to her that if you cannot catch that branch, then you will not catch my chick that will fall out of its nest. So we are to be cautious about who we mate with. Because as an eagle, you have the potential to want to make sure that you have a king or a priest one day. And then for the eagle, male eagles, they want to make sure that they have an eagle that is a nurturer. They have an eagle that is going to train up that eagle, because that's going to be the first face that they see in the right way. So everyone has to do their part. And so even the baby eagles must listen to what the male eagle or the mother eagle and the father eagle say. You cannot just do things your way, because it will be detrimental. It can be detrimental to you. Because if you get out of alignment or out of the nest before your time, there can be a greater prey than your mother or your father. So as we relate that to this team, the GBFIC Eagles, we must obey the handbook. The handbook is the word of God. That is your playbook. You are supposed to read it every day. You are not a good team player if you are not reading the handbook that God has given us every day. Even if it is on the iPads, but you are to read your handbook. We don't want team players that are not studying the handbook of God. B-I-B-L-E, basic instructions before leaving Earth. Basic instructions before leaving Earth. And then when you come to practice every Sunday and Wednesday, it is to build you up. You cannot be a good team player if you're not at practice on Sundays and Wednesdays. You will be defeated by the other team. Because you do not know what happens if the play was changed. We can't afford to have you to get on the field. Come on, give me some of my male team players. Come here, come here, come here, come up here quickly. Give me some more. Yeah, that's good. Come on. Come on. Okay, get in the hut. Here's the team player. They know what the play is. The team player, Brother Alfredo, he gets to run on the field, and they say, snap, it's time to go. He has no idea what they're doing. So the chances are he's going to mess up the play. He's going to cause us to lose or what? Fumble the ball. So when the team, when the player book in Hebrews 10 and Hebrews 10 says, forsake not the assembly of the saints, it's for a reason. Because something may have gotten changed between Wednesday and Sunday and Sunday and Wednesday. Go ahead. And then I want to get on some of you on the team. There are also those when we send out, as the coach, I send out because the owner give me things to send out electronically on the text. And you still don't read the text. Because you think you don't have time. And then you found out that something significant has taken place and you don't know about it because you did not read the text that came out for the GBFIC Eagles. I want to get that straightened out before the owner gets here. We have to be on one accord, one heart, and one mind. If one person fails, then we all fail. It is not you just in it to win it by yourself. You're not a team if it's just you. If Deacon Isaiah makes a touchdown, we all makes a touchdown. If Sister Nakia may run that pass 10 lines, 10 yards, we all get that 10 yards. And if Sister Danielle gets tackled, then it's just like we all got tackled. And we got to get back out there, and we got to figure out how did we get hit? Yes, when she get $1 million, we all get $1 million. Eagles are extraordinary nurturers that meticulously develop their young. So we are meticulously training you up. Meticulously, our handbook tells us how to do that. It says, train up a child in the way it should go, and they shall not depart from it. It says, be better for you to hang a millstone around your neck than to touch one of these little ones. So we're doing some things meticulously. And there are two other characteristics. One finds in, when you look at, in a genuine prophet that has the symbol of an eagle. They are pictured in Ezekiel 1 and 10 as eternal creatures and Job 39 and 27, which presents them as a particular responsible to the voice of the Creator God. You are supposed to be as eagles to be able to hear the voice of God. When it comes through the owner or when it comes through the coach, you are supposed to listen for the voice of God. If you hear any chattering or clicking or any of that, then that is a time where you need to get wise counsel. The eagle is also the symbolic of a messenger. Therefore, it is also applied as today's prophets. So we are messengers of God. You're supposed to take the message that you received today. When we're out on that field, we're playing against some other teams that do not know God. And so when you're out there on the team, when you're out there on the battlefield, when you're out there in the workplace, when you're out there at the grocery store, when you're out there in the schoolhouses, you're supposed to be the voice of God. That's the reason why God has called us eagles, because we'll be able to fly in places that others cannot fly. So they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength and mount up a wings of an eagle. So there you have it. I have given you the history of the mascot symbol that God has given us. Now, before the owner gets here, I just got a text that he'll probably be here in about 5 or 10 minutes. And I want to make sure that we're not playing just playing the part, but we also look the part. So on your sheet here, it says game changers for Christ. What's going to make me a better player? This will look different for each team player. Some of you have fumbled some balls over the last couple of games. Some of you have missed some catches. Some of you didn't kick the ball well. Some of you have missed some practices, but for this new year, so that we can be signed on, we want to make sure that each team player do their part. So what is it that's going to make you a better team player? That's right. That's right. That's one of our water boys there. Amen. Amen. He's listening. What's going to make you a better player spiritually? What's going to make you a better player physically? Read the playbook for some individuals spiritually. Physically, exercising, eating right, nutrients, knee can nutrients. Emotionally, if I'm telling you, if you do number one, it will take care of number three and four. Emotionally and mentally. Because the words in that playbook are anointing. The words in that playbook, it says that when you read them, that they go deep down with inside, down to your bones, all the way to the marrow. It's a double-edged sword. So all you're going to get some hits and some kicks along the way. But you also in that playbook is in on Isaiah 53. It tells you that by the stripes of Jesus Christ, you are healed. So going into the next year, I don't want to hear about that you got a backache, you got a headache. You need to take the source out of the playbook, out of the book of Isaiah 53. You need to go to the play page of Psalms 103. That you are healed. You shake yourself off and you get back in the game. Are you with me, game changers? And financially. Next year coming in, that playbook, you should have the best financial year that you ever will have. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. In the name of Jesus. You're going to have an increase. You're going to receive royalty checks. That's the reason why we're playing a good team, because as this year, what is getting ready to happen? God is getting ready to open. The owner's getting ready to head over him. Not the owner just coming in, but over him. When he comes in a few minutes, he's going to look things out, and he's going to report back to the chief of all chiefs. And he's going to say, how have they done over the year? And the chief is going to open up that book during the Feast of Tabernacles. Our biggest game changer ever. And he's going to see if your name is in there. And you will receive royalties. So you will have, so 2016, 2017 is going to be your best financial year ever. And some of you, those of you that you are, if you are married, and you also that you want to put here, if you have been abused, God, you've been saying that, I've been talking to some of y'all married team players, you like, I'm like, what's going on? You're saying, but maybe my libido low. And I'm like, okay, you need to spend, you know, you need to do some things. So God, he's going to, the playbook even have stuff in there for that. Amen. When you read that word, it's like getting a B12 shot. It tells you now how to have date nights. It tells you now how to have balance. And those of you that have been, maybe have been abused sexually, it's also in that playbook where God has came in and healed and said that he, how he'll heal you. Well, you don't have the emotions. See, I go there. If you do number one, spiritually, it will take care of number two, physically, three, emotionally, four, mentally, five, financially, six, sexually, and seven, socially. We are GBFIC Eagles, and we can't hang around with any other type of team people. So socially, you're going to increase and be blessed. Amen? And so turn your paper over, because I also want to make sure, okay, before he gets here, he has this video that he wants us to put up. And so I'm going to wait for him to get here, and then we'll put the video up. But I want to make sure that everybody has a paper and pen, that you're looking studious. You know, I just don't want you to walk around looking like jocks and don't have any type of knowledge. I think I hear him. I think I hear him coming. Can we get somebody to escort him in? This is our honor, Dr. Adam Blackstock. We've been waiting for you. Well, I was just sharing here with the team. We're glad that you came in, and we've been going over some things, looking over our year. We think that you will be pleased, so you can report back to the chief executive officer. And I do know you sent us over a video. I just decided that it'll probably be better for you to be in here with us when we watch it, in case they had some questions that wasn't able to answer. So I'll turn this over to you right now.
Amen. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. I'd like you to spend about 15 minutes with me to watch this video. This video, it may impact some physical truths, but I know it'll impact some spiritual truths into you. It's coming from a non-spiritual perspective, but it has strong spiritual overtones that if you are looking closely, you can actually feel. I enjoyed the video, and this is sometimes you have to have recommended viewership, right, for things that you want. Look to your neighbor and say, there's things I want. There's areas I want to go into. There's behaviors I want to change. And I want to be a game changer. And specifically, game changers change their behavior in certain areas. So this video is going to present to you those in some areas. Amen?
This mastery session is all about the rules of game changers. And, you know, we become our standards. And that is your standard, then your mindset will operate at the standard that is around you. I mean, we do become our social orbit. And if you are at a standard internally that I want to be a game changer in my field, I want to be BIW, the best there ever was, I want to be the Van Gogh and the Rembrandt of technology or whatever field you play in, then your behavior always matches your internal identity and your inner standards. So your standards are important, your standards for your friendships, your standards for the quality of the work you do, the standards of your languaging, the standards of the nutrition you put into your body, the standards of your love life, the standards of your mindset, the standards of the way you occur in the world. And so my invitation for you, regardless of what you do, is that you raise your game to a place called world class. And that is all about being a game changer. Now, I should caution you, and I don't like that word because language is so powerful, and caution is a word that really is a little dramatic. But I want to caution you, which is, as you leave the herd and the crowd and perhaps the cult of mediocrity and rise to being a game changer, it's a very disruptive act. And you actually threaten the masses of people around you. And that's why every visionary was first ridiculed before they were revered. And I'm sure you've experienced it. You say, I want to take my fitness to a whole new level of world class, or I want to take my craft to a whole new level of world class, or maybe you're raising your game financially, and then you share it with those you love or your friends, and maybe your friends are those you love, and they laugh at you. And how many times have we given up on a dream because we were mocked by the people around you? And all I'm suggesting to you is, when you get laughed at and ridiculed, and when people don't understand your next level of world class, that just means you've got a great dream, and that just means you're on the path of growth. So be a game changer. What are some tactics? Well, I'm going to walk you through a bunch of key tactics, or the rules of game changers. And the first one is really this: no idea works unless you have the courage to do the work. Ideation without execution is delusion. And so there are people who say, well, I went to a course, or I joined an online membership program, or I read a book, but my life didn't change. And I want to say to them with great respect, your life could have changed, but you didn't do the work required to make the change happen. That's almost like an athlete saying, I want to be a gold medalist at the next Olympics, but I went to the gym for 4 days and I didn't get the medal. I mean, the reality is, an idea is the starting point on the process to get you to where you want to get to. So just remember that really building something great is all about execution. When you look at a Steve Jobs or an Elon Musk, or when you look at a Nelson Mandela or Mother Teresa, when you look at a Da Vinci or a Tesla, all those people had the vision, and then they outworked everyone around them to execute on the vision until the product was done. And it's not only execution, it's the grit. Remember grit from previous mastery sessions, which is, you get knocked down, do you give up or do you continue? And any game changer has literally out-persisted everyone around them. And when you get full of self-doubt, which you will do on the path to world class, do you continue? So the first idea is, just remember, no idea is going to work unless you have the courage to do the work. It's all about high levels of execution intelligence. Great leaders and game changers have a bias towards getting things done. And it's like a muscle. The more you do, the more you're going to want to do. You start building this incredible momentum. The momentum feels internal confidence. The confidence wants you to make even more gains, and it becomes this upward spiral of unbelievable execution. The second insight I want to offer to you, which is this: to have the results very few people have, to have the results of a game changer, you need to start thinking and behaving like a game changer. And that means thinking like a game changer, populating your mindset with the best books, with the best ideas, with the best conversations, behaving in ways that most people don't behave. Again, you want to have the results very few people have, you've got to start doing things that very few people do. Turn off the television. Delete the naysayers. Stop gossiping and start producing. Eat better food. Run longer runs. Shift from a focus on what's not working to a focus on what's working. I mean, you really want to install a whole new series of mindsets and a whole new series of rituals that very few people are doing. third idea I want to offer to you, which is this. If you want to be a game changer, here's the rule number three. You will receive from the world who you become. The world is so obsessed with goals. The world is so obsessed with externals. But the doorway to success, I suggest to you, swings inward, not outward. And the best way to have a game-changing life, and the best way to have a world-class lifestyle, and the best way to change the world is to change yourself. I mean, we get from life who we become. I was having a conversation with my mom last night, and we were talking about goals and setting big dreams, and what I offered to her was, you know, it's great to have external success, but the real value of external success is who you had to become as a person and what you had to build in terms of your character and the capacities and the talents you had to polish to get the external success. I mean, that's the real value of success. You build, let's say, a great business or a great family life. That's awesome. But who did you have to become? What did you have to overcome? What talents did you have to learn in order to get to world class? That's the real value. And even if you learn lose the external success, you get to keep the internal gold for the rest of your life. And so I just invite you to play with the idea, which is you receive from life who you are. And the single best move to be a game changer is to work on your character, work on your emotional architecture, work on your mindset, work on your spiritual life. And then you become this force of nature that becomes invincible. And you become this force of nature that radiates this enthusiasm and this inspiration and this self-belief that really brings everyone around you into your dream. And that's why a John F. Kennedy and that's why a Martin Luther King Jr., they didn't really execute on the dream. They executed on their internal power so that the people around them felt the dream and did the work. And that's really what leadership is all about. I mean, I hope you really think about what I just offered to you. The fourth rule of game changers, an addiction to distraction is the death of creative production. The more you can be distracted or you can be a game changer, you just can't be both. And if you look around and you witness how most people are behaving, they are so distracted. When they're driving, I mean, just watch people driving these days. They're driving and they're like this, or they really are still, even though there's a lot of laws in a lot of countries that don't allow people to do it, they're still texting and checking because they're addicted to their distraction. You see people in conversations and they're looking at you and then they're looking at their technology. I've never seen so many people make mistakes. You're at a hotel and you offer your order and it comes back and the order is wrong. Why? People are addicted to distraction and they have lost their focus. And what I'm suggesting to you is if you really want to be a game changer, focus on your vital few. Focus on the few projects at work that will move the needle. Focus on the few activities in your personal life that will allow you to live an iconic personal life. I mean, become a minimalist. Every game changer is monomaniacally focused on just a few things. Number five, if you want to be a game changer, here's the fifth rule. The thing that you're most afraid to do is the thing that is most valuable to do. I'm going to repeat that again because it's so fundamentally important for you to become a game changer. The thing that you are most frightened to do is the thing that is most valuable to do. Your fears are nothing more than growth in wolf's clothing. And I really want you to wrap your brain around this idea, which is your progress lives where your greatest fears lie. The things that terrify you, walk towards those. And the more you do it, the more you build confidence. The more you actually stand in the fire of your greatest fears, the more you actually find freedom. And I know when you do that, it's counterintuitive. And being a game changer is counterintuitive. And I do it in my own life. Like, I cannot tell you how frequently I do the thing that terrifies me. And yes, a lot of my days, I'm in discomfort. A lot of my days, I must confess to you, I'm confused or I'm feeling afraid. And it's messy, because being a game changer is a messy process. But the payoff is simply this. I grow almost every single day. I become braver every single day. I mean, standing, going to the places that frighten you is your bravery training. And the more you do it, the stronger you become, the more free you become. And literally every single thing that you're afraid of, you've given your power to. And every time you stand in the fireplace of your fears, you take back your freedom. And that's a pretty awesome way to live, isn't it? Even though it's messy, even though it feels hard, even though sometimes you're confused. Sixth rule of a game changer. Education is inoculation against disruption. If you really want to be a game changer, you need to be in the rooms that game changers play in. You need to go to the conferences every single quarter, read the books that game changers read, invest in the programs, because education truly is inoculation against disruption. I mean, look at the world, politically, economically, the environment. Look at business right now. We have never been in such a state of acute disruption. And guess what? It's only going to get messier. For the victim, the coming decades will be messy and terrifying. For the game changer, the coming decades will be inspiring and very enlightening. And really, if you really want to be a game changer, invest in your learning. The person who learns the most wins. The person who understands the most can see around corners. And so you want to invest in knowing more than anyone who does what you do in the history of what you do. You want to be able to start seeing around corners because of your level of information and your knowledge. And then the final idea I want to offer to you to be a game changer, the seventh rule, is simply this. The seduction of safety is always more dangerous than the illusion of uncertainty. You see, the world around us sells us this bill of goods to cling to the known, to live within the comfort zone, to never stray out of your community of safety, right? So don't read different books, don't have different conversations, don't reach too high in your job, don't have new conversations with interesting people that you've always wanted to meet. Don't set new goals, etc., etc. Live within your circle of understanding and safety. And to me, that's a recipe for aging. That's a recipe for an early death. A lot of people die at 20 and they're buried at 90. Do not let that happen to you. I pray that never happens to you. And what I'm suggesting to you is the seduction of safety is really more dangerous than the discomfort you will feel when you venture out into the blue ocean of the unknown. And really, if you want to be a game changer, it is about living in the blue ocean of the unknown, playing with new ideas, stretching your internal capabilities. I think it was C.S. Lewis who simply said this, the best way to expand your limits is to go to the edge of your limits. So if you're a runner or you're a skier, I'm a skier. The best way to grow is to go to my limits and ski the most difficult runs. And so when I go to Bariloche in Argentina and I'm at the top of this mountain in Patagonia, I am scared and frightened and terrified and my hands are shaking and my legs are shaking, but I'm growing when I'm skiing down that run because I am pushing my capacities and my internal limits to the very edge of external limits. And that is how you become a game changer. And that is my greatest wish for you. Hi, it's Robin.
Amen. How was that? Wasn't that rich? That was rich. Now, as owner, I want to minister to you a couple of things that God had hit me while I was listening to the manager, while I was listening to your head coach, and even while I was listening to this. First of all, the GBFIC Eagles, if you're in the house, stand to your feet. If you're an eagle, stand to your feet. If you're ready to soar, stand to your feet. If you are you are believing that you're getting ready to get your victory and you're going to be a game changer, you're not going to be living in a safety zone. I heard that GBFIC as a whole is going to strive from this point on not to be first class, not even to be world class. We're going to be Jesus class. Jesus class, it will incorporate a lot of these behaviors, right? But we're going to strive to have our the best music that we have. We're going to strive to have the best website. The website is going to be a billboard for Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, the Holy One of Israel. Our web broadcast will be a billboard of God. When we greet you at the door, you'll feel like you just stepped into Jesus class. When you eat the breakfast that is complimentary, you'll feel like you just ate a Jesus class meal. We're not going to skimp on anything anymore. We're going to step out on the edge, and we're going to go further. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the eagles that are ready to soar. We thank you that you've called us, and you thank you that we're here to deliver. We are game changers. We've had our game change moments, but God, we thank you that you have called us to be different. You've called us to be set apart. You've called us to stand out. Jesus class people stand out amongst the crowd. So God, we thank you that we're not going to be crowd pleasers. We are going to be crowd separators. We know that the devil loses and we win, but we just don't want to win. We want to stomp the devil's head out. So, Lord, we thank you, and we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Go with me to the book of Timothy, 1 Timothy 4. I won't be before you long, but a couple of things hit me as we were watching the video, and I wanted to let you know, as owner and manager and as somebody that is engaged, I can feel the presence of where I was or where I am, and I feel God doing it. You know, the change that happened in my life here recently can be scary, but God has me living outside of my fear and inside of my God likeness that allow me to move further. So when it said step out on your edge, I'm already there, baby. I have nothing to lose, so we're going to do this the way it should be. We are going to be Jesus class. When you ain't got nothing to lose, you can only do what God called you to do, and that is be Jesus class. 1 Timothy 4, we're going to read 1 through 14. Now the Spirit speaks expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. How many people know that this is the time, this is the season that they've been seduced away from the church, they've been seduced away from their homes, they've been seduced away from their marriages, their children have been seduced away from their families by spirits. It could be the devil himself, but it could be actual spirits that have removed people out of their families, out of their homes, even into experiences that you can't see. Speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with an hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats, and which God had created to receive with them thanksgiving them which believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused. It is be received with thanksgiving. For it is sanctified by the word and prayer. If thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourishing up in the word of faith and good doctrine whereunto thou hast attained. But refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. Look at this. For bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness is profitable unto all things. Look to your neighbor and say, yes, I like working out, but if I don't work my Bible out, it doesn't matter. Yeah. Jesus class works equally, physical body,
spiritual body. If you working out at a gym every day and you looking fit as fin, looking like Atlas, it does you no good if your spirit man is dead. So we have to be willing to build up our spirit man just as like we're building up our personal man. Having promise of life that is now is and which is to come. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all expectation. For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach because we trust in a living God who is the Savior of all men, specifically of those that believe, especially those that believe. These things command and teach. Let no man despise thy youth, but be an example of the believers in word, conversation, and charity, spirit, and faith, and pure. It don't matter what your age is. If you're on the team, you're on the team. You got to preach. Say, I got to preach. Sometimes you have to understand that what your role is you have, every has a part to play in Jesus class ministries. I believe that Glory Bible Fellowship is a Jesus class ministry. I believe there's a clarion call for those that want to be saved, healed, and delivered coming to Glory Bible Fellowship International Church because there's eagles in the building, because there's somebody willing to soar, there's somebody willing to get off of their feet and do the work, there's somebody willing to jump up and start to flop and be able to fly around and start drawing people onto the church. I believe that somebody has been asked to do it, and because you're an eagle, you were willing to do just like Isaiah said, here I am, Lord, send me. Sometimes you have to be willing to go ahead and go in what God has called you to do. Sometimes you have to stop and say, you know what, I need to be a part of something special. I am an eagle. I'm not a chickling. I'm not a duck. I'm an eagle, and I'm ready to fly. That's why we're eagles. We could be swans. Swans are pretty. We could be flamingos. Flamingos are pink. But eagles fly, baby. And eagles soar. Eagle could see a devil coming a mile away. That's an eagle. Eagles have a unique way to be able to glide without flapping. So that means they could still do the work without having to do the work. We weren't called to be swallows. We weren't called to be woodpeckers. Y'all not talking to me. We weren't called to be these type of birds. We were called to be eagles, baby, because eagles know how to soar. Eagles can see the enemy, see prey, see an opportunity a mile away. An eagle knows how to feed, baby. An eagle can see a meal and be patient. Sit on a perch and wait for that meal to be ready to be eaten. Sometimes we move too fast. Not an eagle, baby. An eagle knows what right for the right time, the right season, where there'll be no danger. An eagle even knows how to fish. An eagle can go in, dig those talons in the water, pick a fish out live, and bring it to its children. That's an eagle, baby. But look what it says. Look what it says. Look at this. This text is so good. 1 Timothy 4:11 says, these things command and teach. He said, you better go ahead and teach. These things, he didn't say, I command you to. He says, these things command and teach. He's talking to Timothy, baby. Timothy was young in ministry. Timothy was somebody that didn't have what he thought he had. But God knows what's in you, baby. God sees that you have the ability. God has called you. What God is saying is you have the right and privileges to do what God has called you to do, even when it don't feel good. Sometimes eagles got to go higher than some other birds. The reason why they're eagles is because they have the ability to go higher. Some of the young eagles might not know it yet, but I'm telling you that you can go higher. Mediocre people stay right where they at. We got some of those birds around. We know some of those birds. But eagles fly high. I know y'all see me wearing a Hurricanes jersey. The Hurricane mascot is an ibis. An ibis is a unique bird because it flies into the heart of a hurricane. Sometimes you have to recognize there's a special skill set of those that need to fly directly into the heart of a dangerous storm. When the ibis starts to fly, that's a hurricane warning. I'm looking to y'all now. I believe our ibises and eagles are ready to fly. Some of us to fly into danger, some of us to fly above it to warn others. Anybody in the house? Come on, I'm almost there. He said, till I come, give attendance to the reading, exhortation to the exhortation and to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy, with the laying of hands by the presbytery. Sometimes y'all have to recognize, that's where I'm at, that the reason why you could play better than you've ever played before is because somebody laid hands on you. The reason why you could play the guitar better than you ever played before is because somebody laid hands on you. The reason why you could sing better than you've ever sang before is because somebody laid hands on you. Some reason why you could preach better than you ever preached before is because somebody laid hands on you. What I'm saying to you, there's an anointing in you that it just needed to be stirred up a little bit because somebody already laid hands on you. What I'm saying is there's an anointing for each and every one of you. You just need to say, hey, God, I thank you for laying hands on me because there's an anointing that God had for me. So I just believe that sometimes we have to recognize that I could just be anointed to take the garbage out. You know why I can do it? Because somebody laid hands on me. What I'm saying is there's an anointing that I have or somebody else has that is my anointing. Why? Because somebody gave me the ability to do it. I remember way back when I was first starting the ministry, I didn't hardly ever get a chance to preach, and I was happy about that. Why? Because I was in the sound booth, and I believed that I was anointed to be in that sound booth. I could care less about preaching. I could care less about teaching. I just wanted to do the best sound booth thing I could do. I had to work the camera, work the computer, work the every little gadget that was in there, and I was so good at it that I didn't need anybody helping me. And what God did, he told me how important that sound booth was. He showed it to me. And then when I got complacent on how God was using me in the sound booth, that's when God began to give me speaking engagements because I was happy doing the service of the Lord in the sound booth. I was the only assistant pastor ever to be sitting in the sound booth and doing that, enjoying it. And I used to come with a 3-piece suit every Sunday, baby. Every Wednesday, I was prepared. I was looking like, hey, this could be the season of the sound booth experience. I believe that I got the Holy Ghost for the sound booth, and I be sitting there, I have no more shirt, because sometimes I get lost in the word because I was getting bent by God in the sound booth. Matthew 22, go ahead. We got 2 more scriptures and I'll close. I remember when my pastor called me. He said, Pastor, I was Adam then. I wasn't nobody. He said, Adam, you know how to do this? You know how to lay these network cables in the church? I said, where you want them to go? He said, all over the building. I said, huh? I went to school for computers, but really, I was, working in sales all pretty much my life, right? So, as a salesperson and not willing to give up my abilities, you know what I said? I said, yes. I really didn't know. But I was going to read up about it enough that when he purchased the equipment that I needed, I was going to be able to do it. Sometimes you have to be willing to step out of yourself just to get you in your position. He knew, because I had worked with him doing the radio broadcasts way back when. I had worked with him in doing the advertisements throughout the week. I had worked with him on developing some of the things for his other stuff, but he was asking me about an area that I might not have been comfortable in, but I was willing enough to learn to be good at it, if you let me. So I took a moment to go in and be learned and to go outside of my comfort zone. I raised my own heat, if you went to KLC, and I said, you know what, I'm going to do it. And I laid all the network cable in the church, which is, I think, a 40,000 square foot sanctuary and a 30,000 square foot office and classrooms. I laid all the network cables and the switches and the hubs and the computers and, at that time, the high-speed internet was through Time Warner. I did it all. Got up in the roof, got dirty. Snaked everything down to the wall. Put the wall plates on. All the connector, had to crimp all the cables. That was me. Why? Because God wanted me to know. So when it was time for me to have the church or another opportunity, I would not be blind on how to get it done. So if I didn't have anybody, thank God I have my spiritual son here, but if I didn't have anybody, I was going to get this the cabling done. I was going to get the networking done. I was going to climb in the crawl spaces and get up in the ceilings and get it done. Sometimes you have to recognize that God will train you before you need it to be ready for when you need it, you'll already have the training. Game changers get advanced knowledge, not behind knowledge. You can see around the corner. Say, I'm an eagle. I'm ready to soar. Matthew 22 and 14. I'm just going to get ready to give you this two small scriptures, and we're going to close. Matthew 22 and 14 says, for many are called, but few are chosen. How many people know that everybody has some type of calling, but few have been chosen? Look to your neighbor and say, you've been chosen to be an eagle. I've been chosen to be a game changer. I'm chosen. Now, as an owner, I listed last week, as Prophetess was in Iowa, I listed a whole bunch of game changers in their game change moment. Y'all remember that? Eagles remember that because they wrote that down. Woodpeckers have it on their recorder, and they steal it from the church because they bootleg it. Yeah. Stop bootlegging. Get the CD. I'm just telling you. What I remember, we was at a church when he said stealers, people who steal are stealers. Yeah, I mean, the church is producing the CDs. They got their websites. Use the techniques that we have. If you're just sitting there recording it and then you take it home and you're listening to it on your phone all the time, you're missing. You're not blessing. You're blessing yourself, yes, but you're missing out on blessing the church, which increases your harvest. The reason why I'm not trying to get you out. I'm trying to get a harvest to you. And sometimes you sowing the seed of the $3 to $5 that it could be that sold into the church could be the difference between mediocre harvest and game-changing harvest. Isaiah 6. We're going to close. Say, are we going to close? Say, we done heard that before, Pastor. Take it. Then said I, when the person sitting next to you at the church screams, preach, Pastor. I know y'all got to look. Now this, I promise you, this is not my third close. This is the final close. So I'm a game changer. I'm a game changer. Some of us need to have our Isaiah moment. I'm talking to game changers. A lot of us have had Isaiah moments and didn't take notice to what God was saying. Some of us know that we've been called. We've heard the clarion cry of God to us, and we've ignored it. We missed the moment, hoping that moment may come again. How many people know that your destiny is delayed but not denied? There'll be a season when that moment comes around again, but don't ignore it this time. Isaiah, you got it? Say amen. Isaiah chapter 6. We're going to read verses 5 through 8. And this is God showing Isaiah a vision. I'm going to set it up. Isaiah is, of course, a messianic preacher. He preaches more about the coming Messiah than any other prophet. So he becomes what they call the messianic preacher. He's preaching about the Messiah. He's letting you know that God is on his way. How many people know that God is on his way? He'll tell you that. Isaiah will tell you that healing is in his wings. Isaiah will tell you that with his stripes you are healed. Isaiah says, this is not the fast that I've been called. He begins to tell you that he tells you that the coming Lord comes with seven spirits in one man. What he's saying is that there's an experience about to happen in your life, and you need to know about it, because when you know about it, it may not come instantly, but when it comes, you'll know who he is, because I told you about him. This is Isaiah. But Isaiah almost ignored the calling because he thought he wasn't ready. He thought he wasn't good enough. He thought he wasn't perfect enough. Sometimes you got to understand that God doesn't need you to be perfect. He just needs you to be usable. If game changers know that their time and their season is their time and their season, not waiting to trying to wait on the Lord. No, the Lord ain't waiting on you. He just used the person next to you to be a game changer. What God is saying is you need to know that you're ready, and God's saying you're ready when he calls you. Look what Isaiah said. Then said I, woe is me, I am undone, because I'm a man with unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Isaiah began to tell God, God, you're not really calling me. I'm not the one. My mouth is unclean. I hang out with unclean people. Let me help y'all out. I'm smoking dope right this moment, and I hang out with dope smokers. I drink alcohol, and I hang out with alcoholics. I'm a womanizer, and I hang out with a whole bunch of women. I have problems, but my problems are hanging out with other problems. Y'all know what I'm saying? This is what Isaiah was saying. Isaiah said, I curse a lot, and I hang out with a whole bunch of people that curse a lot. I just got off the naval vessel, and the naval vessel just got off of me. What I'm saying is, y'all know what I'm saying. This is Isaiah. Isaiah was telling you, I'm not worthy of what you're telling me I should be doing, God. How many people feel like that sometimes? God, you don't know my experience, but God said, I know all your experiences. God knows what you've been through and what you're going to go through. God knows where you've been, and God knows where you're going. God has been there through thick and thin. He went into the depths of hell just for you. So Isaiah tried to tell God that he wasn't ready, and God said, wait a minute, partner. I done tapped you on the shoulder. If I tapped you on the shoulder, that's telling you you're ready. If I called your name in the middle of the night, that means you're ready. If I kicked you out of your bed in the middle of your sleep and gave you a vision and a dream that said I need you to do the work of the Lord, that means you're ready. Sometimes you need to recognize that God is calling you, and you can't miss the calling. It doesn't matter what you've been through. It doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter the situation that you're currently in right now. If God has called you, he's called you. Game changers here to call, baby. Say, I'm an eagle. I'm a game changer. Okay, let me go. He said, then flew one of the serpents unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this has touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. God said, when I accepted you, I sent you a sign that changed your life. Sometimes you have to recognize, all you have to do is stand up and raise your hand. God will do the cleaning. All you have to do is say, God, I surrender. God will give you the antidote for your sin. Sometimes all you have to do is say yes, and God will send you the answer to your situation. He said, also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? Then said, here I am, send me. Look to your neighbor and say, here I am, send me. Eagles don't sit back. Eagles don't sit back and watch. Eagles get in the game, baby. Eagles are always on the prowl. Eagles are already ready to do the next step after they took care of their children or with the last step. Look to them and say, here I am. Send me. I remember a skit on Saturday Night Live. So this is how long I go back. And the skit says, put me in, coach. Put me in. It don't matter. Everybody on the team got a part to play. Even when you might be at the absolute end of the bench, the person that ain't seen no time in years, you know those persons, they better a cheerleading than they are at playing. But that one time, coach call on him. I promise you, that bench warmer is ready to play. I promise you, if you're an eagle, I promise you, if you're a game changer, you ready to go in and make a contribution for the team. Stand to your feet. We get close. Neighbor, you're a game changer. You're going to start doing from this point on behaviors associated with game changers. You're not going to sit on the sideline anymore. We are going to operate the GBFIC Eagles as Jesus class. I thank you, God, for my neighbor, the game changer, the eagle. I thank you, God, for the breakthrough that you've given us. Now, God, speak to my spirit so that my spirit man lines up with God and it tells me, here I am, send me, Lord. Here I am, Lord, send me. Here I am, Lord, send me.